of all, in terms of readings and from the, I was always amused, bewildered initially and then amused and bored by the way most American political scientists or historians of political ideas read Tocqueville. Namely, they tend to read him as a kind of combination of some things in Montesquieu and a lot of things from Rousseau, because they are taken away, by they are carried away by the first volume. The first volume, more descriptive, looking at this more or less Arcadian life of the United States, a wild, semi-wild United States. It's the second book that gets read less frequently, I think, by because I was in conference rooms when an American would show up and they give you know really much who they were, who were was talking about Tocqueville, but I could simply replace the names, the name of Tocqueville with Rousseau, more or less, and I would get. So this was a vision of optimism, of and a vision of. A belief in a kind of progress, irresistible progress towards something good. But the second volume tells us that this is not the case. And in my mind, this is where we start to understand what we really want to tell us. Now, there are many definitions of utopia all over the place. But one that would, I think, function quite well is what Tocqueville, the phrase that Tocqueville used to characterize public life in France and intellectual life in France prior to the 1789 revolution. And he says, this wonderful formula, he says, in politique abstraite et littéraire, literary and abstract politics. He notices that people are talking less and less about the reality of their life, and in fact about the actual content of life and history, but rather engage in, let's say, what we would say, fantasize about abstract principles with a kind of literary taste, which is to them more important than that. And this is, in fact, the intellectual preface of the revolution in Tocqueville's analysis. So the revolution happens precisely because these people start fantasizing what we would call a utopian order. To me, this definition, Tocquevillian definition of utopia, he was not talking about utopia, but I will use it, youth politique abstraite littéraire. Because indeed, rather than taking care of what happens in history, many people, political thinkers, politicians, poets, and all sorts of other people would rather do this abstract literary presentation. This is one also of the reasons this pessimistic, stoic, worried second volume of Democracy in America made it so difficult for whoever was a reader of Tocqueville to think in utopian terms. Tocquevillian liberalism is hardly a basis for a utopia. You cannot simply, because he's all the time coming back to morals, which is, in fact, the historical expression of human life. It's the morals, in fact, these habits of the mind, these habits of the heart, they change too. And they are the historical expression, the human expression of history. So, if you want to escape both the problems of political anthropology and the problems of history, then you go into a kind of utopia of a construct that you fantasize. And thus, you leave the realm of history to go into utopia. Now, my main point today is that, in fact, I tend to read revolutions and utopias at attempts to escape history, to get away from the unfolding of events and from historical determinisms, from historical path dependencies, and break, let's say, the continuity of history in ways that which that would correct it, that would correct it according to whatever the a certain number of people or one person thinks appropriate, necessary, even urgent. So one should then think in the following terms. What is the regime of historicity of such constructions, of utopia, for instance, and of revolution? There are variations. You can think of reform as well, or this distinction between evolution and revolution. And I think that for proponents of utopias, the idea is to not only to escape space, which is obvious from the term utopia, or but also to escape time. To, in words that have been used in the intro period in various cultures, to escape from history, to boycott it, to finally break free from the, let's say, from the impositions of history. And in doing so, you affirm your liberty and your liberty, your freedom from determinism. And I think in most cases, utopian authors and revolutionary leaders, doctrinaires, are looking for exactly this. In a country like such, in a country such as the Romanian country, there is almost nothing in terms of utopian thought that would be worth beyond the number of relatively, how shall I say, awkward and modest writings. There is very little of that. There's very little of that, and I would claim that, with the exception of some imitation or variations on utopian tropes, can be a regressive utopian science fiction projection of some future with some technology added to it in the first part, especially in the first part of the 20th century. But radical alternatives built starting from a number of principles do not exist. When history seemed to become a problem for Romanian intellectuals, philosophers, poets, even politicians, what was devised instead of an alternative rational order was a proposal to escape from history and build a metaphysical double of history, or negation of history. This is, I think, something at which Romanians have excelled by collecting cultural, ideological, political materials, especially from Western Europe, from Western European cultures, and by contrasting those or combining those sometimes with elements from Eastern Europe, especially Russian culture, Russian utopianism, and Russian Orthodox Christian alternative visions. This connection could never happen in Romania because, of course, in Romanian culture internally, directly, because Romanians were not reading Russian authors. They had to go abroad to the West, and through Austria, mainly Germany, occasionally France, encounter what Russian authors had invented from the mid 19th century on. And this makes it a very interesting example of, anti-historical alternative thinking, which becomes metaphysical without ever coming to, with a few exceptions I will get to them, without ever coming truly political in utopia. So things do not work the way we would like. Our history doesn't function the way we would like. What do? We invent a metaphysical escape from it. I'll get to it. It's a very, I think, peculiar way of dealing with history. Rather than speculating rationally about alternative paths to follow or about alternative ways in which, practical ways in which to reach the good society, you simply forget about all this and create a metaphysical double, which is pretty much something that I call ethnic ontology, namely a Weltanschauung, a system of thinking about the world that endows the ethnic nation with a specific time, not just history, with a specific space, not just territory, in the geographical, geopolitical, historical way, but time in a metaphysical way, which endows it with a being, not with just a national character. So if you want to, a key to that, I think of Heidegger if you want. If you are a Spaniard, think of Ortega y Gasset and Unamuno in terms of devising alternative ways, ahistorical or anti-historical, so ways of breaking free from the determinations of history. It strikes me as a very interesting, shall I say, replacement of of utopias. And this, I think, has to be taken into account when looking at why people try to invent utopias or try to instigate ignite revolutions. It has this deep dissatisfaction with history. But rather than correcting it through revolution or improving upon it through an utopian project which sometimes needs a revolution, in some cultures, Central Eastern European countries in any case, a different path was taken, and that is the path of ethnic ontology. And thus, you are no more the prisoner of your own geography, you are not prisoner of your own history, but rather you break free, and the space becomes the cosmos, and the time becomes eternity, and the national character or the various, the mores of the nation are pushed aside, and in their stead one has a vision of being, of the ethno-national being as a collective metaphysical entity. This has been very strong in Indo-Romanian culture, and if one looks at this, then the alternatives that were more political and more concrete, by comparison, are really completely primitive and uninteresting. And I'll give you some examples. Of course, the far right produced. But what the left was doing was imitate a number of either Narodnik or socialist, usually Russian, ideas, which were again discovered either in the West by traveling there for study, or brought to the Romanian lands by Russian exiles, Russian and Jewish exiles who were coming over, bringing these ideas. Or both, sometimes were Russian and Jewish, but most of them were both Russian and Jewish. They were bringing these visions, or some of the more, let's say, a number of rather eccentric, I would call them, Romanian students in the West discovered the same type of ideas, and they were not interested in social democracy or socialism the way it was, you would know it from Germany or from Austria. They were quite relaxed about it. This is not true of the area where about which Stefan Borbély spoke, of Transylvania and the Banat, because Hungarians, Germans, and even Romanians from Transylvania, through their belonging to a different geopolitical order and cultural order, had access to the things in the West that you are familiar with. Here it was a specific combination of these elements. And I think many of them German, many of them Spanish, from this generation of 98, which are in the turn a reaction, a Spanish reaction or a Spanish version inspired by German scholarship, because some of these people will go to Germany as well to study there and help be exposed to the thought of German thinkers. So in many ways, this alternative that is proposed by the 98 generation bears the imprint of German culture and German philosophy, very much like Central Eastern European cultures, which originated in that. There is a triangulation, if you want, one wants to do it. And that's, it is very interesting to follow. And the triangle is Germany, France, Russia. And it is quite interesting to see where Central Eastern European countries place themselves at various times. So there is always a combination of elements coming from three cultures. And it is always interesting to see which side of, towards which pole they tend to gravitate and when. And what mix do they come up with from these elements? That these elements are always there in some kind of dialogue. This makes the interest, to me, it makes all the more interesting the study of Central Eastern European, I would call it, well, para-utopian, because this is not really utopian. You have seen last year in Timisoara somebody trying, trying to look at examples of utopias from Hungary. Not really that many, and not really that utopian in our, let's say, more narrow technical sense. But rather, fantasies, imaginative excursions or escapes from reality rather than anything else. Why? Because of this, I think, interplay of the elements that I mentioned, which boiled down in the 1920s towards the 1940s in the shape, in the form of ethnomonologies, which, again, in Gaudi, I mentioned something absolutely idiosyncratic, specific, which is their utopia. If you can take it as an ethnic utopia, that would be a radical ethnic utopia, which is just for the ethnic group and excludes everybody else. And which, of course, is predicated like traditional utopias such as Plato, Plato's Republic, on the cosmology of the cosmos and the polis, which is embodied in the human being, in the in citizen of the polis. So you have this kind of vertical system of homologies between the cosmic and the political, having the person, the ideal person in between. Plato, I think, the political anthropology in the Plato's Republic is exactly this key or this link between the cosmic order and the polis. Hence, the insistence on, I would say, rather on the, rather than on the political arrangement of such an ideal order, on its metaphysical foundation, that I named space, time, being, and on the political, the ideal political anthropology of that alternative space, alternative order. This is why in Eastern Europe, you have an insistence on the new man, on the novi hominis, say in the plural and gender blind, on the novi hominis. This is that these, especially on the right, first in the 1930s and 40s, and then after World War II, on the left, there is so much insistence on creating the new man. Both the avant-gardists in Romania were the other fascists, quasi-proto-fascists in Central and Eastern Europe, were very keen on building this new man, because this is what they lacked most when it came to, you know, to populate their political discussions about politics are relatively secondary. They are mostly, I would say, mystical, religious, metaphysical. If they are more secular, they are better in metaphysical at least. And every concrete form of political arrangement, for instance, that the right wing proposes, is so spiritual and so mystical that it looks more like a form of millenarianism than as a form of utopianism. It is absolutely striking to see you. First of all, if you look at the upbringing of those who are proposing such things, most of them have studied theology, where they studied theology and philosophy, and of course struggle with the fact that they want to develop a system, an ideal order, for which they don't have the population they would like to have. So these people have to be somehow built, the novi homines, educated somehow, even forcibly. So the ideal system they have, let's say, is a very idiosyncratic ethno-national variation on some classical forms of political order. But what matters is not that this is, for instance, when they come up with a totalitarian vision of their ideal society, the emphasis is on the person who is at the center, and that is the Romanian peasant. There is also almost no place in some of these, let's say, para-utopian projects for almost anybody else. The peasant is the ideal citizen, and with this you go back to this situation which is at the bottom of ethnic ontologies. There is this circular process by which you have to create, to engineer, something that you should already possess. So the perfect citizen is something that you have to create based on the idea that you already have about the ideal citizen. So first to define the ethnic Romanian in a certain technical way, metaphysical way. So you claim that such people already exist. You then discover that only the peasants, and probably only some peasants in some remote locations, were not perverted by modernity, not perverted by the Jews, not perverted by the Hungarians, and so forth. So I have to go and locate them, and there are very interesting initiatives by groups of sociologists and ethnographers who go all at great lengths to identify them. Find, let's say, isolata reservations of such perfect aboriginal Romanians, who then would become, through some process that is never fully explained, the ideal inhabitants of this world. I spare you the details because you don't have that much time, but one, as we visited the monastery today, I have to tell you this. Some of these theologian philosophers, Dragnea, Nikifor Krajnik, very anti-modernist thinkers, some not just publicists, they have to go and when they come up with this idea of the ideal totalitarian state built on the peasant, they have to invent a spiritual and religious genealogy, because Orthodox Christianity, the way they knew it, was not enough. So they are going back to the 17th century and identify Mogila, the metropolitan who was active in Ukraine but also went through Romania, and apparently was the person who was the first to indicate the superiority of Orthodox Christianity over Western Christianity. So I had to go all the way to identify elements of that to make that project of a totalitarian peasant utopia, to make it plausible, to make it credible. So they were always in this deficit of credibility, because nobody, everybody knew that such persons did not exist. And thus the basis for the formation of the ideal order had this big problem. There were no citizens for that utopia. They have to be created. How do you create them? By the circular process of the creation of what should be innate. So on the one hand you say it is innate, people are born like that, they look like that, are like that, their mind is structured like that. They were doing, for instance, ethnographic work and asking them, what do you think, what is, and they discovered, for instance, that the peasants in some peasants in some mountain places would spontaneously say that the lead is bad, negative, bad, and so forth. Whereas the right was good, everything luminous, good, and so forth was right, and everything. And they said, you see, even these, you know, timeless, immemorial civilizations know that the right, they were the far right. But anyhow, the right is the good thing and not the left, which in fact politically didn't even exist in Romania. So what I'm getting at is this. In most cases, from the classical utopian texts or revolutionary tracts, I think we see an attempt to overcome history, to negate it, to displace it, to break it, and introduce a project, and thus has a big problem, the problem of finding its own regime of historicity. Where do you plant this? Where do you link? Where can you place this in history? Because you end up with a project that doesn't seem to fit in the history that we know, doesn't seem to have historical antecedents other than the traditions that you have just invented. And you can hardly document the text that existed even 10 years ago, let alone 300 years ago. And so you build an ahistorical, metaphysical ersatz of history. And this is what most of these people were proposing in the operation. And that is my understanding of what they were doing. And probably this is why political thinkers in Central and Eastern Europe have had such a hell of a time to imagine the good citizen of a good democracy and work with that. They would rather invent, in the West, such creations existed, and I mentioned Heidegger as probably the pinnacle of that kind of thing, that what I call ethnic ontology. But then there were forces within German society that took some part and some of the historical traumatic experiences to break that mold and move on. In this part of the world, I'm still working on it, so I don't know how long it will take. Thank you very much.